Hi there, I'm Judy Holland, and welcome to Happy Nest, the podcast where you can hear the latest research and best advice for living well when your kids leave home. Join me as I interview experts and explore how to reinvent yourself during this critical passage. I hope you'll head over to judyhollandauthor.com and check out my new book, Happy Nest, Finding Fulfillment When Your Kids Leave Home. Welcome to another episode of Happy Nest. I'm here today with Katherine Newman, a professor of sociology at UMass and expert on so-called boomerang kids. If you like what you hear, I'd really appreciate it if you would subscribe, rate, and review my Happy Nest show. It's easy to do on Apple Podcasts, or you can go directly to the podcast section of my website at judyhollandauthor.com. Boomerang kids, who are mockingly known as failed fledglings or growing ups, are young adults who come home to live with their parents for a spell. Katherine has researched boomerang kids around the globe and penned a great book about her findings, The Accordion Family, Boomerang Kids, Anxious Parents, and the Private Toll of Global Competition. She tells parents to stop fretting and moralizing over young adults lingering in their parents' home. She argues that today's young adults are not slackers. They are facing a different reality than their parents did: lower wages and the higher cost of housing and education. Young adults bunking at home is a reasonable, rational response by families to tough economic circumstances, she says. Most of these boomerang kids are building a better bridge to the future. Welcome to another episode of Happy Nest. Today we're looking at the boomerang generation. Boomerangs are young adults who are doubling up with mom and dad. They are known mockingly as growing ups or failed fledglings. Today more than 24 million young adults in the United States are living with their parents. In 2014, adults aged 18 to 34 were slightly more likely to be living with their parents than they were to be living with a spouse or partner in their own household. To better understand the boomerang phenomenon, I'm here with Katherine Newman, a sociologist and interim chancellor of the University of Massachusetts. Welcome, Katherine.
Thank you, Judy. Happy to be with you.
Katherine has taught and run academic programs at Johns Hopkins, Princeton, Radcliffe, Harvard, Columbia, and Berkeley. Wow, you've really moved around, Katherine, haven't you?
I have been very fortunate.
She's also authored 15 books, which blows my mind because I have just barely managed to finish my first one.
But you have many other careers behind you, Judy.
Okay, thanks for that. When I was researching my book, Happy Nest, Finding Fulfillment When Your Kids Leave Home, Katherine's book caught my eye. It is The Accordion Family, Boomerang Kids, Anxious Parents, and the Private Toll of Global Competition. Katherine, census data shows today that one-third of young adults are boomeranging back to live in the family home for a while. Why is this happening in the United States?
Judy, there are many reasons why this pattern evolved, and we are not the most egregious example, I might add. The Southern European countries and Japan are way, way ahead of us in this regard, where with much higher proportions of their young adults, if you want to call them that, are living with their parents for a much longer period of time. We're really in the middle. And I got interested in the United States because so many journalists were writing about us as if we were the apocalyptic vision of the future, whereas in fact, the apocalypse, if that's what it is in other countries. Uh-huh. But it has been growing in the United States for a variety of reasons. First, people need more education to succeed in this economy, and education has become expensive. So they're staying at home in order to shelter the costs that would otherwise ramp up if they were living in student housing or dormitories or whatever. So part of it is just the cost of education has been growing, mm-hmm. and people are looking for ways to shelter those costs. I think the second point is that for many parts of the economy in the recent past, entry into the labor market has been rocky. This was particularly true, of course, during the Great Recession,
right?
2007, 2008, 2009. And for a long time thereafter, we had very high levels of unemployment, very disrupted labor markets. It's a different story right now in 2019, but if we go back a decade, we see how difficult this was for young people leaving college. They were finding themselves blocked in the labor market, and to some degree that followed them for a long time thereafter. A stumbling entry into the labor market will follow an entire generation and slow them down from creating their own households, from marrying, from having children, from signing up for mortgages. And the long shadow of the Great Recession really did amplify what were already some disturbing trends in the labor market. So those two things in combination, I think, really made it very difficult. The last thing I would add is that we have defined this as a pathology. And in my book, The Accordion Family, I try to argue we shouldn't be thinking about it that way. That it is, in fact, within certain boundaries, a noble effort on the part of families to try and advantage their children as they launch into the adult labor market. And that that is what families have always done. They have always been there for their children and tried to advantage them, because it's an intergenerational project, the launching of succeeding generations. And so we should back away from this pathological definition of what people should be doing, which was born, I think, out of a great deal of optimism in the immediate post-war world that the boomer generation was raised in. And those are not the conditions that we face anymore.
Right. And I'm delighted that you said that, and I couldn't agree with you more. And certainly raising kids and young adults and life in general really is about involving all the generations. And that's the first thing that caught my eye when I was reading some of your book, is that I hear so many people so alarmed about kids returning, and they feel like it reflects badly on them and their parenting. And I think they're missing the big picture. So I'm delighted that you're drumming this idea home. So tell me about, I know you've also done all kinds of international research. So where else in the world, Katherine, are kids, what are the trends in Spain, Japan, where else are kids returning back? Or I don't mean to say boomerang in a derogatory way. It's just that the visual of a boomerang is easy for me to understand.
So when I wrote my book, the argument I made is that this pattern of young people either returning or never leaving the family home is pronounced in places that have very weak welfare states. And it is almost absent in countries that have very strong welfare states. So let me start with the latter, because I think it's easier to understand. In countries like Sweden and in the Scandinavian social democracies, the phenomenon we're describing basically doesn't exist. Kids leave home when they're 18, sometimes even earlier. I mean, I found when I visited families in Sweden that if you were interested in studying in a high school in a different city than the one where you grew up, the state would pay you to move, provide housing, put you on a stipend, and away you go.
Wow.
When you have that level of welfare state enrichment, if you will, you do not see this problem, because the state has stepped in to provide the resources that in other countries, you're on your own.
Yeah.
In addition, in those countries, higher education is free. Free. Right. No loans,
wow.
No costs. It's free.
That's an entirely different universe.
In Germany, it's free.
Yeah.
So if you are in a country with that kind of welfare state, you will not see this sort of accordion family develop. Now let's flip to the opposite. In countries like Spain, Italy, Japan, you have a very weak welfare state. When you have a weak welfare state, the first thing that happens is the family home becomes everybody's savings account. And there's very little in the way of rental property. There's really no rental sector in those places. Everybody is living in owner-occupied housing, which is very difficult to acquire if you are a young person in a weak labor market.
Right.
So in countries like Spain, where even after the so-called recovery, you have, you know, 40% unemployment among people in the age group 18 to 25, they're not going to be able to buy a house. And there's no rental sector for them to turn to. Unlike Sweden, where a third of the housing is in a state-sponsored rental sector.
Yeah.
So you will get people returning home because there isn't an option for housing that's an affordable option.
Katherine, you just can't find a house, right? You can't find an apartment.
No, because there's no rental property. You just have to buy, and you can't afford to buy when you have no job or you have no permanent job. So a lot of other changes have gone along with this. It's not just that there's no rental property. It's that jobs in those countries, in the weak welfare states, have now become so ephemeral. They are not permanent. They're not long term.
Yeah.
And so employers are hiring people on temporary assignments and then letting them go. Well, then you don't have the assets to buy a house. So anyway, the point is the economy is completely organized completely differently in the weak welfare state and the strong welfare state. Now, the U.S. is in the middle. We actually do have a lot of rental housing. We have some welfare state supports, but not as generous as the Scandinavian social democracies. So we're really, and that's why the pattern of home boomeranging, if you will, is really in the middle for the United States, because mm-hmm. we do have rental property, which means you can get into a housing market without having a huge down payment. But we don't have as much of the supports that the Scandinavian countries do. We don't offer free higher education, for example. Actually, we charge people a lot of money for higher education. So we're in the middle. And living at home is a response to all of those structural conditions in which the U.S. is in the middle and those other countries are on one side or the other of us.
And I think I understand also that I've looked at some of the numbers for housing costs, apartments, condos in the Northeast cities, places like New York City, places like Washington, D.C., and they're just, they're astronomical and relatively astronomical. And apparently in the South, it's not as expensive. So you tend to see more kids boomeranging back if they're in the Northeast cities.
If they're in the Northeast cities and they think they need a master's degree to survive.
Right.
Yes. The combination of higher education costs and extremely high housing costs will tend to lead to this boomerang pattern.
Right, right.
So it's not just some sort of psychological crutch is my point.
Yep.
It's not some lack of maturity. I mean, maybe for some people, I'm not suggesting this is always a wonderful thing, but it is. The boomerang pattern is families responding to these structural conditions in the labor market, in the education market, in a context of modest welfare state support. And in the other countries we've talked about, it's a different combination.
Well, bring me back to, I speak Italian. I lived in Italy for a couple years, many years back, taught English after I graduated from Middlebury. And so I actually encountered a lot of mamone. And talk to me a little bit about that. It really jarred me in my early 20s. I noticed back then how many 20, 22, 25, year olds were living home with their parents, because that was just it wasn't going on where I came from. What's with that culturally in Italy? And again, yeah, how has this come about? Isn't it, I think your book said either 2/3 or 3/4, it's a really big number, of Italian young adults live home really pretty long, right?
Yes, very long, and even longer now, because Italy's gone through economic crises. So what I found really interesting as a social scientist is that once you understand all these structural patterns we were talking about, you still have a lot of cultural variation in how people understand the problem. So in Italy, I found that families didn't understand why the rest of us thought this was such an issue.
Right.
They didn't think this was pathological. In Italy, it has always been the case that young people lived at home until they married. But what's happened is they're not marrying, or they're marrying very, very late. So the practice of living at home until you marry hasn't changed. It's the age at which you marry that has changed. So from their point of view, it's like, why is everybody else in the world so spun up about this? This is our culture. We love our children. This is not a problem from our point of view. Whereas the very same condition, the very same pattern in Spain received a completely different interpretation. In Spain, the families that I interviewed for this book, or that my research assistants interviewed, were very angry that their children had no alternatives.
Ah.
In part because this is the generation, the adults were in the generation that had survived the Franco era. And in the Franco era of fascism in Spain, these very strong traditionalist values were imposed on people. Marriage was imposed. No birth control was, but all the sort of extremely conservative views that went along with Spanish fascism under Franco had been the rule of the day. And the parental generation rebelled against this And they were angry that these conditions were imposed on their children. And so for them, this was a tale of government malfeasance, of corruption, of a country that had swallowed fascism whole. And in the post-fascist period, which wasn't that long ago, I mean, Franco died in 1975. So the generation I was interested in, who were parents, who became parents, you know, in the 1980s and 90s, remembered this era very well. And so from their point of view, this is the government defaulting on a promise that their young people ought to have. There ought to be housing. There ought to be jobs. And the fact that there wasn't was seen as a failure on the part of government, not a failure on the part of their children, a failure on the part of their government. In Japan, by sharp contrast, this was seen as a complete pathology of the Japanese family, and it was associated with what they saw as a failing generation of young people, a morally defective generation, and a morally defective family pattern in which the fathers were working themselves to death.
Literally
working themselves to death, and therefore they regarded them as absent fathers. And so it's interesting because you heard this language about absent fathers in the United States when we're talking about low-income families where, single-parent households. That same language of moralistic blaming it's been very true in the U.S. when people talked about the poor.
Yeah.
But in Japan, that same language was adopted to describe the middle and upper middle class, because fathers were gone working in Tokyo all day long and coming home, you know, at midnight and never saw their children. And so very often they define the origins of this bankrupt, morally suspect younger generation in that absent father. So every one of these cultural adaptations, if you will, comes out of the history and values of those countries. But what was fascinating to me was that how that variation unfolded even when the underlying structure was pretty much the same.
Right.
A weak welfare state will lead to this pattern, but the interpretation is very different depending on the politics. And the same thing in the U.S. We have a culture too. In our culture, as long as people are striving to get somewhere, well, we will adapt, right? So if your young person at home is getting a master's degree, that's a very different reason for being at home than if they're not doing anything.
Right.
So we have our own moralistic vision of
what people
should be doing. And preparing for the future becomes an acceptable reason for being at home.
So I think a lot of us had years ago probably seen that movie, that I think it's Failure to Launch movie.
Yes.
And that probably did a lot of damage. I think that guy was not striving for a master's degree, right?
No. And that was going to be the original title of my book till that movie came out.
Oh, I hate that when that happens. I've had that happen. Yeah, that's kind of a funny movie, and certainly there are circumstances probably somewhere along those lines, but today
I think they're not the dominant reason, but we are very susceptible to this moralistic journalism culture in which everybody starts to feel ugly and awful about themselves.
Right. Well, what about, you know, how when kids are, and again, one in three kids, you know, coming back to live for a while is that's really a large part of our population. And a lot of the census data that I've looked at and things that I've read indicate that this is a trend that may well be here to stay. I've spoken to people at think tanks and they say, don't expect this to evaporate anytime soon.
No, I don't think it will.
Because we still have all the economic factors. We still have expensive apartments. I have a singer-songwriter in Nashville who's lived in about five houses since she graduated from Wesleyan 3 years ago, you know, all over Nashville, because they cram people in houses because the rents are through the roof. And again, that I understand, Katherine, is very different. When I was that age, when my parents were that age, it was a lot. You know, when my grandparents were that age, people could come out with a high school degree, get an apartment and live on their own. And now it's very different. And that's, I think, something that people lose track of.
Yes, that's very true.
That we're not facing the same situation, that our kids are not facing the same economy, the same rents, you know, and that we need now because of our move toward an informational society? I guess that's what you call it, as opposed to, you know, since so much of our manufacturing has gone overseas, you've got to be better educated and you may need to go back to school longer and kids are taking longer. I just read that 50% of kids haven't graduated from college after 6 years for a number of factors. So it's a longer road to adulthood. And therefore this boomerang phenomena is, it actually makes a lot of sense.
It does. And of course, we also have to remember that student loan debt is absolutely astronomical in the U.S. And that's because states have backed away from supporting public higher education and have left that burden to families. And as that debt piles up, the option for buying a home, for example, recedes into the background. It's just not possible. And not just buying a home, marrying, having children, all of these dynamics are tied to economic opportunity or lack of it, and to the cost of pursuing any of those goals. And they're very high. So I guess my message is, I think we should stop beating ourselves up about this adaptation and actually recognize that families are trying to step up and help their children launch in as best a way they can, given all of these circumstances. Yes, this can get out of hand. Yes, it can become, you know, a sort of indulgent life where nobody's trying. But I found that to be an extreme minority. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, this is a practical solution to a series of structural barriers that have been very hard for young families and for young people to deal with.
Mm-hmm. So given this thing is here to stay, this is going on, I have a lot of friends who are actually concerned because their kids are boomeranging in and out. How should you, if you're a parent and your child returns home to get a master's degree, to save a nest egg, to buy their own apartment, to any number of things, do you have practical tips for how you should handle young adults returning to live under your roof?
Well, I think it's important, you know, every family has their own culture, and far be it from me to be prescriptive about how people should organize.
But I asked you.
But I think it's always good for parents to have honest conversations with their children about what they hope for them, what they expect for them, how they can be helpful. I do think that they should, you know, at least in my culture, they should take a hand in helping in the house. They shouldn't expect everyone to provide everything for them, do all the cooking, cleaning, whatever. You know, they're adult members of the household, and sharing the work that goes with it, I think, is a reasonable expectation. But, you know, that's what I think. That doesn't mean it's something, a prescription to write for absolutely everyone. Honesty between generations is important. I also think we should understand that our young people are probably going to bear a certain amount of responsibility for us when we get to be elderly, and that there is a kind of intergenerational reciprocity that has always determined family life, and that's not going away. So what is a helping hand from parents to children becomes a helping hand from children to parents in other parts of their family lives. And I don't think that's a sin. I think that's what families have always been there to do for each other. But some degree of sort of honesty about what the resources are and the hopes are, and some sympathy for the difficulties that young people face as they're looking for work or looking for housing, and rather than a hyper stern moralism that says they're failing if they didn't achieve goals that aren't really achievable in this generation. A little bit of slack, a little bit of understanding, in my opinion, is worthwhile. But that's speaking more as a parent myself, as a human being, and less as a prescriptive social scientist.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, interestingly, I did an interview with Jeffrey Jensen Arnett, who writes about young adults. I'm sure you're familiar with his work. His studies have shown that when this is handled right, when this boomerang situation is handled well, and parents manage it well and have meetings about it, and that actually it can be a time to fill in gaps and to be a better parent and to get to know your child as a young adult. It's actually, if we frame it right, and I know psychologists and sociologists talk about the way we kind of frame things and look at things, if we frame it right, it's actually a very good opportunity to get to know your children as young adults. And if you look at it that way and realize that in America, you know, in America, we all kind of move separately from each other, and we're not as intergenerational in terms of families as others are in other parts of the world. Perhaps this is really something to embrace as opposed to cringe from.
Well, I think it can be. And in fact, it was very striking to me that when I got to Sweden, where, again, this pattern does not exist, and I would ask people, why do you think it's so different in Spain? Because they were very well aware in other parts of Europe, this pattern of young people leaving at 16 or 18 was not the norm everywhere. And it was very interesting to me what the Swedes would say. They would say, well, we're like this, not because we have a generous welfare state. We're like this because we don't love each other as much as those other countries do.
Wow.
And there was a lamentation there that was quite palpable.
Yeah.
It was as though the lack of need between generations was driving a level of what we call anomie or disaffection or distance that they didn't really feel was all that healthy. They felt like they were more atomized because the relationships between generations in those rich welfare states are not as interdependent. And, you know, they can turn to the state for all kinds of supports, right? If you are an elderly person, at least when the time I was doing this research, if you are an elderly person in Sweden, a government nurse, a government funded nurse would stop by to see you six times a day. And your children did not have to worry about whether or not you were managing because there was a whole resource available, which to me as an American sounded like nirvana. Can you imagine how many American families would appreciate having that kind of consistent support instead of worrying about how they're going to care for the elders in their families? But in the Swedish context, they would say, well, so, you know what? We don't go visit grandma very much. We don't have to. Or we don't, you know, our children are, you know, they leave us when they're 18 and we don't really see them very much after that. Well, it made me appreciate a little bit more the integral nature of family life in the U.S. because I don't think I would be very happy that way. And actually, they weren't all that happy. They were more economically secure.
Yeah.
But they weren't all that happy. So, you know what? This is the great value of doing research around the world. You see all these permutations and you realize that some of the things we think of as liabilities may actually be virtues, you know, if they're not taken to extremes anyway.
Right. No, that's a great gift of being a sociologist. I've interviewed a lot of sociologists recently, and I've come to realize it's a little bit like being a reporter, except what you could do is a lot more in depth, and you move around, but you're looking people in the whites of their eyes and really getting to understand their lives. And that's really in a very profound way, you can understand what's going on when you do that.
That's what we try to do for sure.
Yeah, no, it's fascinating to me. So wrapping up, Katherine, what just off the cuff advice do you give parents? Again, I have friends who are wringing their hands and concerned that their kids are boomeranging in and out. But in most cases, their kids are going to school or switching majors or switching tracks, or, you know, they tend to be building toward the future, but it doesn't look like the way that we lived when we were that age. So how do you just put those people at ease?
The first thing I do, this is self-interested, Judy, but the first thing I do is tell them to read my book.
There you go.
Because the book tries to provide them with ways of understanding what they're going through that takes the individual out of the equation and asks them to look more broadly at how these patterns are unfolding among millions of people in their own country. And I think when you understand that you're not alone, this is not your dilemma by yourself, it helps make sense out of things and take some of the sting out. But the second thing I try to tell them is every generation really confronts a very different set of economic circumstances. So we may think this is one country, but it's a lot of different experiences. In the baby boom generation, the generation that's now, you know, headed into retirement, when you look at the economic conditions of our childhood, we were in the most prosperous country on the face of the earth. The post-war baby boom saw wages rising, fathers who could go out and on a single income support their families, moms who stayed home, and they produced the baby boom. That's why I have three siblings, you know, where nobody I know has four children now. That was a different world economically, and it provided options and opportunities that just were not available to the generation that came of age, for example, in the early 1980s, the first time that unemployment crested at double digits.
Yeah.
Right. Or you know, the unemployment that rose after the Great Recession. It's just not the same world when those are the conditions that face your children.
Right.
My father went to college. He was the first in his family to go to college. It cost him $100 because he had the GI Bill.
Yeah.
There was no tuition in the University of California. Well, today, the students I have here at the University of Massachusetts, Boston, you know, it's costing them $28,000 a year, and we're the cheapest alternative in this city.
Yeah.
So it's a different world. We may think it's the same country, but those are very different conditions. And we should just stop blaming people for having to contend with a different set of conditions and a different set of investments. I mean, in my youth in California, I was the first generation to be charged any tuition at all in the University of California. Why was that? Because the citizens of the Golden State were picking up the tab and investing in a fantastic public university that built the prosperity of that state. Mm-hmm. Today, the University of California gets 7% of its budget from the state. The rest is in tuition from families.
Right.
So public policy is playing a big role here in what families are facing, what students are facing, the debt they have to take on, and the calculations they have to make to survive. So I tell everybody, vote. Pay attention to the policies that you're supporting or not through those people that you vote into office, and then cut yourselves a little slack, because right. this is not an easy period of time for anybody. And I think we should admire rather than castigate families for stepping up and doing what they can for the next generation. That is an honorable purpose for the American family.
That's wonderful. Katherine, thank you so much for all your insights. And again, I appreciate all the traveling and touring and studying and sampling that you've done to come up with these conclusions so journalists
it's a pleasure, Judy.
Journalists like me can come up and boil it down and bring it to other people. I think this is a wonderful area of study. And again, there's a lot of concern these days with the 1 in 3 young adults returning home. So it's a really appropriate and timely subject. And I'm here with Katherine Newman again, whose book you may want to check out, The Accordion Family, Boomerang Kids, Anxious Parents, there are plenty of those, and The Private Toll of Global Competition. So thank you so much for joining me, and I'm signing off with another episode of Happy Nest.
Thank you, Judy. Take care now.
Thank you.
Thanks for tuning into my Happy Nest podcast, where we explore how to get the best out of the empty nest. I hope you'll subscribe, write a review, and reach out to me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Check out my website, judyhollandauthor.com. Have a great day, and remember, make it happen.